very much. This lecture is about a sort of collage of things that we are talking about. We'll revisit them as we go on. And the best definition I found for chaos is dance of order and disorder. So this is a new definition in some ways. Actually, this word is quite old. There were two words, cosmos and chaos in Greek. And now the way things stand, it's almost chaos is a combination of these two. But let's try to understand what is cosmos. And Pythagoras actually called the universe a cosmos, a beautiful order, and explained that the world structure arises from the harmony or the fitting together of different elements through proportional relationships. So cosmos is very much tied with determinism. And from 15th century onwards, quantitative methods became very popular in the case of determinism. Precise measurements is all that they thought that mattered, you know, so then you could get the best results. Now, the culmination of this is Kepler's work. And Sivertonik in his book says, Kepler, when he finally found out the elliptical orbits and he published it, he wrote it in a style that is not going to be very popular with today's Physical Review Letter editors. And the whole thing, I'm sort of leaving it here as a sort of subliminal impact, I hope, on you, because it shows the joy of having done something very wonderful and worthwhile. But I'll read at least a lengthy portion of this, and recognized its truth beyond my most sanguine expectations. It is not 18 months since I got the first glimpse of light. 3 months since the dawn, very few days since the unveiled sun, most admirable to gaze upon, burst upon me. Nothing holds me. I'll indulge my sacred fury. I'll triumph over mankind by the honest confession that I've stolen the golden vases of the Egyptians to build up a tabernacle for my God far away from the confines of Egypt. If you forgive me, I rejoice. If you're angry, I can bear it. The die is cast. The book is written, to be read either now or in posterity. I care not which. It may well wait a century for a reader, as God has waited 6,000 years for an observer. Next slide, please. So this is, the planets really moved like a clockwork. The cycles and epicycles, which themselves were rather beautiful, they now were being overcome by beautiful ellipses. And then the ultimate, in my opinion, pinnacle of determinism is represented by Sherlock Holmes. His whole sequence of events, the cause and effect, and so on. Very, very rarely does he ever say, well, if there's a slight change in my observation, would my entire conclusions go completely wrong? Everything is indeed quite elementary to him, as Dr. Watson keeps on getting amazed at him. Next slide, please. So this is really what Kepler was working with. This is the show that man has seen, and somehow it seemed to have made sense. Determinism was quite important for astronomy, and astrology was totally dependent upon it. People sincerely believe that the position of the stars at the time of your birth, that is the initial condition, will determine your entire life. But the motion of the moon caused some doubts, and that was important, because moon was important for navigation, for deciding the location where you were. Actually, it's the people who were starting a new magazine, new journal in Sweden, convinced the King Oscar II of Sweden to announce a prize of 2,500 kroner to really ask this question that was bothering people, will the sun rise tomorrow? Formally, is the solar system actually stable? So this great man, Poincaré, he proved the answer is yes, the solar system is quite stable. Prize was given in a great sense, and in fact they said you should write it up as a paper. So paper was reviewed by honored referees, it was approved, and they started printing the whole work. Until one evening, Poincaré looked back and suddenly realized there was something perhaps wrong with his calculations. So he went on, and he found out what we... In fact, he came fairly close to saying these words. The word chaos has to wait now another 85 years before it comes. Sensitivity to initial conditions. At the same time, boundedness. In fact, so chaos was born but not yet named. There are two paths actually. Poincaré is claimed by both mathematicians and physicists. But these paths are actually quite a bit different. On the one hand, the pure mathematicians or maybe the highly theoretical physicists, and then the applied scientists on the other side. Actually, the applied scientists forgot about all this for about 70 years, Poincaré's work. So essentially what we work on, in fact all these problems, deal with what is called flows and maps. Flows can be represented by this. This is where the skier is right now. And you want to know what path he will take. So you want to know all the twists and the turn of this particular pathway. And that can be written in some form of differential equations. And then from the initial conditions, you find the entire path. On the other hand, there is the other dichotomy, which Professor Narasimha talks quite a bit about, is maps. You don't care how, what, and what mechanism. You say, how do I get from here to there? In fact, the theory of chaos deals with both flows and with maps. So 70 years have passed now. Nothing much has happened from applied science point of view. And then in addition, in order to study the weather, and this is the solitary equation in this lecture for Dr. Kapoor's benefit, in order to model this weather in a rather simple form, Lorenz at MIT, a meteorologist in 1963, found out a whole bunch of things, and he said essentially the smallest influences can have very large effects. Actually, Ueda, 2 years earlier in a slightly different equation, Duffing's equation had done this. But this is something I found out in order to search for this lecture. It's amazing. Three people in 1963, Lorenz of course, but Feynman. Apparently, in fact, he was the most succinct in the way he explained this. And Gene Roddenberry, the creator of Star Trek, all in 1963, Lorenz studying the weather. 1972, he coined the term butterfly effect. In fact, he essentially said that if there is a small butterfly flutters in Brazil today, would it cause a tornado in Texas 6 months from now? So this is actually rather coincidence that when you take this equation, and if you say, well, there is an X and a Y and a Z, and if you plot how the various points move, actually you get a pattern that practically looks like a butterfly. So this was a flutter that was heard around the world, the flutter of this butterfly. Feynman actually spelt it out quite succinctly. And Roddenberry wrote a precursor to Jurassic Park. He in fact talked about it as a biological thing. And it all happened in 1963. So now there are some ironies in this story. The mathematician's way, the applied way, that goes on. And I'll sort of jump ahead in time and tell you what the supreme irony is. In 2001, just last year, at Potsdam in Germany, there is an experimental chaos conference. And there is a young Polish participant asks, he says, I'm a mathematician. Please tell me, does mathematics have any role to play in chaos, in this work that you people are doing? The leaders of the conference politely told him no. You know, this is really just an applied science. It's for physicists. Chaos is a part of physics and physics will take care of it. So I asked actually, I stood up at this point and I said, are people aware of Poincaré's work? And they sort of didn't want to say they don't know Poincaré. But then when I asked about Sharkovsky, they said, certainly, you know, that can't be very relevant, you know. So who is Sharkovsky? You know, certainly nobody at this conference knows. Who indeed is Sharkovsky? Well, here is a person, he's giving the talk. 1 week later, not too far away, in Augsburg. And at that point, he's the keynote lecturer on chaos. Why is he so important? Actually, Sharkovsky is known for his order of natural numbers. Here is the order. All natural numbers can be ordered in this way. You take all the odd numbers in ascending orders, then odd numbers times 2, odd numbers times 4, etc., etc. Finally, no odd numbers left, and then the descending order of the even numbers. Any number can be ordered like this. And what he said was, take any of these numbers, supposing 10. If you have a period of this, then all of the periods are going to be there. 11, all others will be there. And then in special case, 3, all others will come. Now it turns out that there is, of course it says that period 3 will then imply chaos. It turns out that, next slide please, 11 years later, and in a very restrictive case, but now Chaos is named and Lorenz is the mother by Lee and York in a physics journal. In fact, they have even been nominated for Nobel Prize for their work, which is late and extremely restrictive. Now, here is another story that I want to tell you related to this discovery of chaos. And this is taking place on the beach of Copacabana in Brazil. Smale is a professor at Berkeley. He's taking a sabbatical with Palis, actually. He was his former PhD student. And he just spends most of his time here rather than sitting in his office. So he's watching all the natural scenery that is around here. And on this, he drew a horseshoe. In fact, he wrote an article about how research should be done on places like this. So if Bill Gates were to donate us $1 billion, I suggest my director that we should all be funded to go to Brazil so that we'll do even better work. Okay, so what did he find? He found a horseshoe. Well, it wasn't as pretty as this, I admit, but this was a nice picture to show you. So what happens in a horseshoe? You take two points. If you take a point here, another point here, it starts going farther and farther and farther, which is sensitivity to initial conditions, which is what we understand. But that happens in ordinary cases. Normally, when that happens in linear systems, you will just keep going and you go off to infinity. But in this case, you cannot turn and twist, and you in fact come closer to where you were. And then you'll go around in various type of ways. So this shows other crucial properties of chaos, which Smale found out. These notions about boundedness and these little things called unstable periodic orbits. This whole bunch of little limit cycles, which we'll talk about a little bit later, which have to be there. A property of mixing that is also very, very crucial in the case of chaos. Next slide, please. And something else is going on there. There are a bunch of at least three, in fact, a couple of more, and some hippies in Santa Cruz. They are all students. Typically, these are in physics now. And they are all bored. They are not getting anywhere. They are never going to finish their PhD. So they thought, well, let's if we don't get a PhD, let's at least get rich. Actually, they ended up getting both. So they are at UC Santa Cruz that has a seedy boardwalk. And it has these roulette wheels. And the whole idea is, let's try to predict. If you know what number the roulette wheel came to now, what would be the number next time? They want to make money by predicting the roulette wheel at the Santa Cruz boardwalk. Why is the roulette wheel random? They can understand why quantum mechanics, at least they think they understand, why quantum mechanics, quantum clock is random. But why should this little mechanical device be random? And they sort of went through this and they said, well, it really is not random. It has certain way of determinism about it. In fact, they tried to find some order, they found some order. And they did some very interesting things about try to be rich here. They didn't want the people to know they have this system. So they had, of course, computers were not compact those days. So they were carrying these heavy clothes, hiding some computers-like devices with little lights and so on. There is a book called Eudaimonic Pie that talks about their efforts. Well, they didn't make much money here, but Farmer and Packard have this company called Prediction. And they really have multi-million dollar contracts trying to predict stock market and currency prices for the Swiss bank and so on. Crutchfield is a professor at Berkeley, quite a famous one. Next slide, please. But during this period, all these people were very depressed. In fact, they called themselves the people of the chaos cabal. Mandelbrot is another person, kept on losing jobs from one place to another. Feigenbaum was denied tenure at University of Virginia. Mandelbrot just wouldn't get a job. Luckily, IBM gave him some sort of a spot to work on. And he was then said, well, if I can't get tenure and if I can't become famous, let me make money. So he was trying to find out what we will derogatively call cotton satta prices. And he was trying to find a pattern in this. I gave some discussion of that in a talk on God and man playing dice at NIRS just recently. So he finds this particular picture, which is, in fact, a portion of it is really utterly beautiful. It's extraordinary how many places you will see. In fact, I've seen a four-hour movie which takes you from these nooks and crannies of this, like some ancient cathedral. You never run out of things to see, and all these beautiful objects keep coming back at you. Next. So now there is a certain period where lots of people said, you can't be serious. Professor Narasimha was telling me about his experience at Caltech. Farmer Packard talked about, they went and talked to Berkeley and talked to the professors there. Those who had worked on these problems for all their life, they said, you can't be serious. Not the Duffing equation, it won't show chaos. And then they finally said, okay, maybe. But this is just a mere pathology I should not worry about. And in fact, Gleick talks about this quite a bit. His book is the book that actually was very much inspired by Thomas Kuhn, who talked about how scientific revolution takes place. And it's like a whole galaxy exploding in front of your eyes. If you're an astronomer, right in front of our eyes, a scientific revolution was taking place. So Gleick actually studied all these people and he tried to see what they were going through. And one key thing they talked about is that the people were warned by their supervisors and colleagues that such research would cost them their respectability, possibly their careers. And this is literally true. A very large number of people have suffered a lot by working on this. But the subject was so attractive and that kept you going. Rule talks about, in fact, he made some very interesting observations. He said, if you have a very, very bad paper and very, very good paper, you can be sure both will be rejected. You know, and he said, second, and he makes some very interesting comments, which I wish I had known somewhat beginning of my career. But he clearly talks about this. His association of turbulence with strange attractor, he says, was so revolutionary, he was not able to publish his paper. And finally, published it himself. So this is not quite recommended. So things were going through this stage, and then finally it came to somewhat next stage. Sort of continuous retreat of the opponents. Okay, but no chaos in my home stage. This is in a way what Samuelson talks about. What happens to people who oppose you? They actually retire or die, but they don't usually change their opinion, usually. So it takes almost a generation to take place. So this, I gave a talk in mechanical engineering department here on this topic. What has mechanical engineering to do with chaos? A statement a series of head of the departments had told me as I was working in a slightly less friendly place than IIC. Next slide, please. And then all that changed was entertainment. And it was Jurassic Park. It's interesting that Roddenberry, 63, had come out with this idea. These were the people who said, what if when you try to revive the dinosaurs and you make a slight error somewhere in your whole process, what could happen? Somehow this movie became enormously popular. See, all these years when you talk to the graduate students, try to get them interested in working with you on chaos, nobody wanted to see you. They just walked away from the corridor. And now you are mobbed. Whole bunch of people wanted to work. And why? Because of this movie, Jurassic Park. You know, they were totally fascinated by this and they said, really, there is something to this. We want to understand this. About a little bit earlier, Gleick wrote this book, Chaos, the Beginning of a New Science. And it was number one on New York Times bestseller list for a long time. And that really had some impact. So people felt all the crazy things we are doing, maybe they're going somewhere. Next slide, please. So chaos became cool, to use this particular phrase. And then we started coming, and this phase has not ended yet. This is the phase from about 87 till now. Chaos is everywhere. You can still publish papers saying, well, this subject, it is chaotic. Okay, I mean, you can keep doing this. You can keep doing this. I mean, things keep surprising you even now. The process of corrosion, it seems, to really understand the basics of it, you have to understand it is chaotic. Okay, next slide, please. And actually, it turns out, this whole view of chaos has changed. This is soon after Poincaré. You can think of these as the steady things, things that do not change with time, things that are periodic, things that are quasi-periodic, which are almost periodic in certain sense. And then random, the Gaussian random and other kind of random processes we talk about. 1890. I have a little bit of this color, but you'd hardly see it. That is, Poincaré has found it. He hasn't given a name for it. Nobody else has noticed it. This was the state here. Now, when you go to 1970, say about 7 years after Lorentz, people realize, yeah, there are some things which are chaotic. You can keep publishing. You can talk about this. And everybody will say, well, isn't this chaotic? And one can go ahead and try to try to establish this in a rather nice way. And then we come to this stage, which is really almost everything is chaotic. In fact, Palis, who is the student of Smale, has shown that virtually anything, any nonlinear equation more than three dimensions, generically has a probability that it will be chaotic. Next slide, please. And so now the question is, okay, all right, maybe things are chaotic. I'm managing okay with the work that I'm doing. How does it affect my day-to-day work, you know? And so then you start to try to say, well, what is the status now? Where are we now and where are we going in the future? Well, first we have to recognize there is a lot of bad chaos. And the question then is, can you sort of have a premonition for it? For example, the ECG signals, the heart signals. It turns out they are normally nearly periodic. In the case of arrhythmia or heart attack, they become chaotic. Wouldn't it be nice to know a little bit in advance, hey, things are going chaotic. That means you've got to see a doctor, do something about it. Speech signals also. You know, the things that affect the stroke, that affect the speech centers of the brain will affect your speech and in fact turns it somewhat mildly chaotic and then quite a bit more chaotic. Now, there is actually on the side good chaos. There is music. In fact, all music, this might be an extreme statement, but I can defend it. All music they'll keep listening for a long time and will sustain popularity has been chaotic. They looked at Indian classical music, Chinese classical music, Western classical music. It is highly chaotic. What's surprising is the brain signal. In fact, Dr. Pradhan played a significant role in trying to establish that these are chaotic signals. Why are they chaotic? Why are you communicating? Why are you using your command control communication system using chaos? This was rather strange. So this premonition and control, we can sort of look at it like this. This is periodic, this is chaotic, but it's not all like this. There is part of chaos which is very nearly periodic and sort of mini chaotic. When you come to this end, it becomes indistinguishable from the random signals over here. So supposing you are here and you start in this region, when you are at the mini chaotic things, this can be seen as a premonition. And you can take various kinds of control algorithms to try to control this. So this is one possible application that you have for chaos. So then the question again for brain, why would brain use chaos? Now actually there is a study that we have done where you take tent map, which is the very canonical map actually for this, and you take 50 signals. You mix them up. And then it turns out you can separate them one by one, like Neera, Kshira, Viveka. You know, this you can't really do with the periodic signals properly. So mixing and turbulence. You know, you want things perhaps to be more properly mixed and more thoroughly mixed. The ergodicity property of chaos is very relevant about, in this case of developing good mixing combustion chambers, for example. Now, why should music be chaotic? Well, periodic is repetitive and boring. And random, totally unpredictable would be cacophonous, would sound really quite harsh and does indeed. So this whole thing, the being in the groove, this melding, chaotic synchronization, we talk about that a little bit later, that actually makes it helpful if things are chaotic. This is the cosmos side of chaos that we will come to fairly soon. So this is called chaotic synchronization. Well, what is the background? If you have two systems, even with the slightest difference in the beginning, they drift farther apart. If you take two different oscillators, and if you're running them with a computer, two different computers, and in fact, there is no other prediction, there is no closed form solution, as we'll see, there is no integration. The only solutions you can get for a chaotic system is using a computer simulation. Even if you take two different computers, use very good alternative methods, you get different answers. Things drift farther apart. But with a feedback system perfectly in tune with each other, it turns out, and you get the how you do this, the slide, it will be on the next slide. So you can get some connection. In fact, the two things get synchronized, even with an earlier time delay. You know, it turns out that the things come closer. So with a, you can show chaotic synchronization, you can say why it works. In fact, we later showed how it can work with time delay. Because we are partly inspired by these notions of jugalbandi, how fish and bird communicate, and how they seem to know what they do in time that is faster than the normal time of communication. Okay, I'll just leave this here to sort of at the back of your mind that this might even perhaps have something, some explanation of EPR paradox. So this is the hint of cosmos in chaos, as we were saying. So what is the idea? How do you get this particular chaotic synchronization? Here are two different oscillators. One is sitting here, one might be sitting quite a bit farther away. And it turns out that you can say there are three different components to this, x and y and z. In fact, you can see it as a differential equation. Rate of change of x1, rate of change of y1, rate of change of z1. How they change, that has been defined by some equation here. The exact copy of it, for example, will exist here. And all we do is that we send part of this x1 to this x2. In a simple case, you just override this x2 by this x1 and you let this thing go on. y1, yz1 and y2, z2 are quite far apart in the beginning, but they come together and they start marching in tune no matter what happens in an amazing manner. This was a little extra thing you can do. If you are receiving this particular signal, you can build another such device. You can send this y's to create synchronization and then you can check if this x2 is close to x3, and that in fact tells you, although you don't know what the sender is doing, how close these two things are. Well, obviously this has a potential for cryptography, which we pointed out, but the most interesting thing is about jugalbandi. Actually, it turns out that this is a constant thing. I have talked to several musicians, especially jazz musicians, and typically it seems North Indian musicians. And then they'll talk with you about this. They like to talk about it. They say this is a spiritual experience. They use the terms like being in the groove, the term melding, and essentially people communicating with each other, doing things that are not repetitive, not even fully predictive to others, but they're working together and doing the same thing. Next slide, please. So, if you are still not convinced, you say, well, I don't wear black clothes as this man from Jurassic Park seems to do. What's in it for me? Well, then I'll say, well, okay. Chaos, we are claiming too much. It's a narrow territory, at least in terms of modeling. It is a subset of all nonlinear problems. And nonlinear, most people will be happy with. They say, fine, you know, I work on nonlinear problems. Although it turns out that first, most things are nonlinear. Okay. And in fact, Ulam has this wonderful example people will tell you. That there is a man who went to Stanislaw Ulam, the great mathematician, and he said, I work on non-linear problems. He said, it's like a zoologist coming and saying, I work on non-elephant zoology. You know, almost all animals are non-elephants. So almost all problems are actually non-linear. So why are problems non-linear to begin with? Okay. So here is a simple answer to this. I think you would probably hear God snore if the world was linear. Okay. So what linear models cannot do? In fact, this is one interesting question. People realize that linear models are bad, but why do they keep working on this? There is a very simple story about this. The story about, well, here is a culprit actually, that Schrodinger was lucky. Just as Newton was lucky when he was working with two bodies, although the equation was non-linear, it turned out to be non-chaotic. Three, it became chaotic. That's a different story. But Schrodinger was extremely lucky. He worked on the model is linear. And in fact, Feynman has eulogized it by just writing the equation and saying the entire chemistry follows from this single equation. But how far can you go? And how many times can you use linear models? How many times can you be lucky? Very few times. People realize this. Why do they work on linear problems? It's almost like a person who loses his keys, you know, in some dark alleyway. And then he comes under the place where there's a light and he's looking for the keys. And people say, why are you looking here? He said, look, I can't look there because it's dark there. So they know. They know the problem is non-linear. But they said, these are the problems I can solve. This is what I can do. So here is a very interesting thing that happens. In fact, one can create a catalog, and that itself will be fairly long, about the limitations of linearity and what beautiful things are not accessible to you for linearity. This is a very beautiful object, and this was created by an electrical engineer studying the heart. He wanted to understand this process of how heart beats in a certain way, and supposing you go up a stairs, it starts beating fast, but it comes back to the normal level. And then for some reason, if your heart slows down, it will again come back again. There is some sort of a what is called homeostasis by the medical people. How does that take place? You can't find this in linear systems. It turns out that if you start the system slightly away from here, it will slowly go and reach this sort of a more darker line. If you go outside, it will come back to that darker line. This dark line that you have is not an equilibrium point, because it's not one fixed point, but it is a very interesting stable situation. You go away from it, you come back to this. You go inside, you go out there. This idea of being far away from equilibrium and yet being able to have some sort of a sustainability is in fact a very new idea and a new concept. This concept is as old as the beginning of the 20th century, in fact, very well understood by Van der Pol, but still not fully understood and used by us. Chaos consists of a very large number of these limit cycles. And in fact, it turns out in this case, the limit cycle is stable. In the case of chaos, there are a whole bunch of, in fact, countable infinity to be precise, number of such orbits, and all of them are unstable. But together they create some kind of an extra attraction, so you are going. So it's a continuous flirting between one limit cycle to the other that takes place. This idea of unstable equilibrium might be very relevant if you think about this interesting concept. When you study chaos, Greek mythology, it turns out chaos had several children. One is very familiar to many of us, which is Eros. The another is Gaia. And Gaia is a sort of a mother goddess in a certain sense. And this is a beautiful picture of this Gaia, the daughter of chaos. And now people see this, the beautiful blue marble, as essentially in some ways Gaia. We realize now and recognize it's a non-equilibrium system. You are not at steady state. A planet in steady state does not look blue. It has lots of methane and so on. The amount of oxygen we have is because of a deliberate equilibrium that has been there between the eukaryotes and the prokaryotes that exist on this little thing. In fact, just as we have cells in our body, and just as they do not have individual identity and we become one person, we are mere cells in some sense in this larger body, this whole thing, which is a living, breathing thing called the Gaia. You can see it this way. Next slide, please. Actually, it turns out, now we are going into other disciplines, slightly outside of immediate nonlinear dynamics. And these interactions are developing, and in fact, I predict that they are going to grow. Statistics and chaos certainly are going to get practically married to each other. Randomness is almost the flip side of chaos. And there are several aspects to this. Professor Narasimha pointed out to me, I didn't know, that von Neumann during World War II, in fact, just wrote down an equation. I don't know how. He said, y is equal to 4x times 1 minus x. Just take any x between 0 and 1. Do this, 4x times 1 minus x. You get the next one. And then if you want the next number again, now treat that as x and keep doing this. This is the map. What he noticed is that the sequence you got seemed to satisfy most of the criterion of random sequences that existed at that time. But he said, look, this looks random, but it's not. Obviously not, because I can keep precisely determining the next point. So this was quite an amazing thing. Now, somehow people outside of this field are not aware of this. Feigenbaum seems to have worked on it, more or less on his own. And May in ecology studied this. In fact, in ecology, this is known as a logistics map. And in terms of this, and found some interesting properties of this. But they were not aware of the connection. Cross connection between various branches of statistics and chaos are mutually unknown to various people. Next slide, please. So most are unaware, and I hope I don't get corrected by Professor Shankar who is here, that pseudo-random number generators are actually chaotic generators. Okay, next slide please. So I want to dwell a little bit and sort of go in a venture in a slightly farther out area. These are now we are going in a speculative realm of things. And that is because I am quite fascinated by this comment by Einstein. God does not play dice with the universe. And actually what was happening here was that there is this the correspondence principle. Next slide please. And the idea simply was that special cases should follow from general theories. And in fact what Einstein said something slightly more than this. He said this principle does not hold for non-integrable systems. What is a non-integrable system? Non-integrable system literally almost means non-solvable system. Of course, before the computers, it meant there was no solution available in a standard classical form. Now, only reason we work on all these problems is because now we use computers, we don't solve the problem. We imagine we are solving, we are creating a metaphor, we are creating a story, a narrative. I mean, postmodernism is very much connected with chaos. And so it turns out that first we had a story like this. The idea now was that the classical mechanics should be a subset of the quantum mechanics. And the idea was, supposing I want to do a little pendulum analysis, the back and forth. Well, I can use Schrodinger's equation, take each molecule, it'll take me forever, but I should get the same answer. And in fact, this is the idea. That this is just a subset of a larger theory, and the larger theory now is going to take care of everything that you need. What Einstein is pointing out is that, look, a little bit of this is peeping out of this, because this is where you don't have exact solutions to the equations, you have this non-integrability. And so this was the next point that came up. Where we stand now is that we are seeing almost all the problems of classical mechanics are non-integrable. If you take any real pendulum, with real masses, with real number of things, equations, by the time the number of items go more than 3 that are connected with nonlinear linkages of different kinds, the chances are, in fact, if you want to bet your dollar, you bet that it's going to be chaotic, non-integrable, strictly speaking. So this is where you stand. So there is always this enticing question that Prigozhin and others are asking, is that, is there some larger mechanics that treats this and this both as subsets? This offends a very large number of physicists, and that's part of the fun. But this question certainly is going to be asked, and the question is, who's going to play this role of this larger green disk? Would it be chaos mechanics? Next slide, please. So when you look at these two things, chaos and quantum mechanics and determinism, almost all of 20th century was a struggle. Determinism was really suffering in various ways. Quantum mechanics said simultaneous accurate measurements are impossible. Chaos said, well, look, okay, even if this were not to be true, even if you knew precisely where you were, long-term predictions are impossible. There is an interesting shadow lemma that says, well, you get this metaphor, you get some kind of a trajectory, you find some sort of a future path, but it must have started, in fact, you will say there existed some path that must have started pretty nearby where you were, but you don't know exactly where. So Professor Narasimha sort of humorously commented that the future might be well understood, but it's the past we have a problem with. So you can't win either way. Quantum mechanics, you have trouble with the past. Chaos, you have trouble with the future. And the entire 20th century slowly has eroded the determinism. Like to see what Sherlock Holmes thinks today. Okay, next slide please. This is the last thing about, in a way, chaos and quantum mechanics. And this is interesting outside of even quantum mechanics, because Einstein said quantum mechanics is an effort to model something which is deterministic, non-linear, by a linear stochastic model. At the time he said this, there was the word chaos wasn't there. Maybe Poincaré had found this, but really there was hardly any awareness of this, and nobody paid much attention to what he was saying. But now in view of chaos, these words are becoming almost prophetic. So deterministic nonlinear systems are almost always chaotic. Palis, the horseshoe co-conspirator, the student of Smail, who was sitting with him, at least watching the scene at the beach, while Smail was drawing his horseshoe. So now, I've been looking at this question from different perspectives. One of the things we did rather successfully is that we took again the canonical tent map, and we saw that the duality of Einstein is indeed valid. A stochastic linear system can be arbitrarily approximated by a non-linear chaotic system. Next slide, please. This is another thing which is very, very popular in statistics. A friend and somebody I admire greatly, Vivek Borkar, he is quite an expert on this. So you want to try to understand what these particular processes are. And what you can do with this Markov processes are many interesting things. You can say there are prisoners who are flipping coins and they're trying to escape. There are three different ways. For example, there is a way here, there's a way here, there's a way here. They flip a three-sided coin, if you imagine, and or whatever way. If it's one, they jump maybe one-third way this way. Two, wherever they are, they jump one-third way this way. Or three, they jump one-third way this way. And if they keep doing this, actually they don't escape, because the random sequence of events means they keep going between this. Like the Buridan's donkey, who finds two sets of food so attractive, keeps on jumping between these two and never goes anywhere. So you get a picture. And that picture roughly looks the way we will see fairly soon. Now you change the picture slightly and you get a beautiful fern, as you will soon see. Now this is, there is the people who just work on it as a Markov process, they are not aware at all that there is something interesting you can do to the same process. You run time backwards and actually what you get is chaos. And this is a very useful thing, because for example, we'll show you that we take a noisy fern and we say, let's go backwards. And actually, I'm going to present this now in Hyderabad next week. And the whole idea here is, there is a thing which is called a Julia set. See, mathematicians kept on working after Poincaré had finished. So there is Julia, and in fact, about the same time, almost independently, Cantor came out with something which is essentially what the whole Mandelbrot set is. And in fact, all chaos is a product of Cantor set with just a circle, with a loop, K cross S1. So you can take a noisy fern and you can make it less noisy by using this chaotic idea. And in fact, the same idea, you can take many, many signals and add them together. You can use this notion about a Julia set. So this is how a prisoner's escape path will look at these different points. And it doesn't look terribly, terribly interesting. You can see that there are some places, if you haven't been there, you can't get there because of that jumping rule that you have. So this part is the part that gets excluded if you aren't there. Once you're out of there, you'll never get there. And then the images of this will come up, and then the multiple images continue. So the part keeps on excluding. What is interesting about this is that you can actually count and calculate. How much do you lose? You say, how much area do you lose in the first time? How much area have you lost the next time? So this plus these three and so on. You get a simple geometric series, you add up, and the answer is you lose the entire area of the triangle. Nothing is left in the triangle. But then what are these points we are seeing? Well, they have a little thickness, that's why we see them. But supposing they have no thickness, then what would you see? It turns out, although you have removed all of the triangle, you have removed nothing. The number of points that are remaining are the same as the number of points in the original triangle. Both are uncountable infinity. A property that a middle third Cantor set has, and all these are relatives of Cantor. So when you look at a Sierpinski triangle, you should say, this is another Cantor set. Now Cantor himself had a very interesting life, as you know. He became mad. Nobody believed him. Nobody believed him. They thought it was crazy. In fact, the top mathematicians thought that he was being very, very crazy. In fact, all we have chaos is just a Cantor set put to some music. Next slide, please. So this is just another Cantor set. Okay, with a slightly changed numbers. And you see something quite beautiful. In fact, it's quite lovely. You try to magnify it and you keep running the program. It will not pixelize. It will just keep growing and do all kinds of wonderful things. The joy that you feel when you generated this, and in fact, this was done much earlier by Barnsley and others, but we re-simulated it. It was extraordinary. It took some time for Savita to come out with this stem. And the joy that one found when we got these little stems itself is quite amazing. But this gives you a new perspective. In fact, to a large extent, some of the joy that is being expressed by Wolfram, Professor Narasimha talked about this alternative algorithmic point of view, that joy can be seen here. That the mathematicians always said, things are beautiful, math is beautiful, but they never could express it. Now we go other way around and say, beautiful is math. What you recognize and see as extraordinarily lovely patterns have certain underlying mathematical symmetry to them. And so you look at a pretty girl and you say, this is a person with fewer equations than other girls. Now this is not going to get you very far with the girl, but there is some truth in this. Okay, next slide please. So this is a slightly less pretty fern. Why? Because it has been contaminated by higher order dynamics, which is really what noise is. So now you inspect each point, you say, do you really belong to this? Now if you go backward in time as chaos, you run it forward. If it is an imposter, sooner or later it leaves this square and goes out. But those who are true will keep staying there. These are the true prisoners who stay within the prison and never really leave, going back, going the other way in time, obviously. So if you do that from this, you can get the previous picture quite nicely. Might have some, in fact, applications. So I'm now talking about other things, not directly related to chaos, but that are going to have a lot of interaction. So this whole question in entropy, we had this wonderful lecture in this idea series. This arrow of time, in fact, there are now quite a few people are speculating. This is what is called campus colonialism. You like your subject so much, you see it everywhere. So these chaos people are certainly very much colonialists, along with George W. Bush, and they want to see it, spread it everywhere. So they believe that this is the reason. This is the asymmetry for time. The world is not Hamiltonian, it does not have non-dissipation, there is dissipation, and that dissipation in a way is affecting and creating this direction of time, and entropy itself is an indication of the existence of chaos. Information is very much linked with chaos. In fact, the loss of information is an interesting thing. And it is very interesting what happens. If you are going forward in time, chaos is very hungry for information. It says, if you want accurate predictions, keep feeding me more and more and more accurate data about where I came from. In the beginning, a little bit of information is reasonable, but then say, I want more. And you will run out of information about where I came from, and then your predictions are gone. Going backwards is different. It's like a Hansel and Gretel in a black forest. You have to drop small seeds of just roughly where you were at each time. You're going backwards. If you just keep track of those little numbers, then you precisely zero in where you were going backwards. So that's the funny thing that happens. So this interplay of information, in fact, coding theory itself and chaos is certainly a very, very growing area. Technically, there are lots and lots of entropies that are being used. This week, it's the turn of topological entropy. Savita and I are very much in love with this concept and trying to do very interesting things about this. But it has a lot to do with this question about what information gets lost, what potentialities get lost. People, I think it was Professor Kumar who came once and he was very excited about this paper by Robinson. He said, three equations are enough. You know, take any system, if it is developed by a differential equation, if you give me a path that is followed by some trajectory, then you can model it with just three equations. Is that right? And then I looked at the proof seems right. But now there is something else I think that matters, which is called the Kolmogorov entropy, one more person's entropy. What is Kolmogorov entropy? It says, if I can predict what, I can understand what the particle is doing, what are its neighbors doing? If you can predict it easily, then there is less Kolmogorov entropy. Otherwise, there is a lot of Kolmogorov entropy. What happens in chaos is, you may even understand what a person is doing, but you don't know what its neighbors are doing. And in fact, that's where the interesting issues are coming. Okay, now they said there are some things which are barely have anything to do with chaos. But there is a lot of new mathematics that is crow traveling with chaos. And I think it's a very, very beneficial thing. And I think there are lots of fields, I believe, by this extra mathematics injection. See, very few people use 20th century mathematics. In fact, very few people use 19th century mathematics. Most of our methods that engineers and physicists use were developed in 18th century and before. So, did nothing happen in 19th century? Well, nothing much happened in 20th century. Well, actually, lots of new mathematics happened. But the divergence between mathematicians and the rest became much bigger. The language became terrible, and there is a reason for this. An engineer who is to be blamed. His name is Lipschitz. He was an engineer. He I think, had some injury with his body. His legs were lost or something. And then he became an ultra-pure mathematician. Became very powerful and important person. He started demanding rigor. That rigor led to what we call rigor mortis in outside of mathematics. And the result was that mathematics cannot be understood by anybody even slightly outside of mathematics. The language has become extraordinarily complicated. But some beautiful things have come out. And it's an extraordinary effort that it takes for an outsider to try to get a glimpse of what is going on. The biggest gain is going to be, I think, in the biomedical area. But of course the hardest, because you know, I gave a talk at University of Pondicherry to biology and mathematics students together, and I talked about the coming marriage of mathematics and biology. And I said, here is a story. Mathematics goes and proposes to this girl called biology and says, let's get married. She says, get married to you? I left the town because of you. When you talk to the biologists, they'll tell you. They'll tell you when they had to choose in school, they chose biology because they hated mathematics. You know, of course, Dr. Pradhan is a great, notable exception to this, but this is by and large true. But this is where things are going to really come together, willy-nilly. I think it's a shotgun wedding that will take place. Next slide, please. And of course, economics. This is a subject quite ripe for this, and because prediction is the thing that they thrive upon. And it is some sort of external stability that economists live by, because their forecasts are terrible, but they still keep finding some way to explain away by using various kinds of little tricks, how to lie with statistics, for example. A really great thing is pictures from data. This is something that came out of Farmer and Packard, actually, those gamblers, delinquent PhD students from University of Santa Cruz. So, this is a very exciting subject and quite a useful one. Next slide, please. Here is an example I want to give you. You take this question about finding out the odd man out. You want to identify a speaker. So, supposing you are given a lot of speech data, and supposing there is a lot of data that belongs to one speaker and another belongs to somebody who is outside. Now, you can just look at the data, it doesn't look that terribly interesting. But you can convert it into these pictures. In fact, we have found somewhat a way of making really prettier pictures, and there are some interesting reasons why they are pretty. I think these are pretty. And these pictures have extra topological properties all of a sudden, various knots and all these topological invariants. And those are the characteristics which do not change, some of these characteristics. The reason you recognize it's my voice is because there are some topological invariants that are associated with me. These are two different speakers, and there are two different cases, again trying to find the odd man out. Perhaps more useful is this case. People look at the ECG data and they look at this P, Q, R, S, T signals again and again. Instead of that, this particular picture, I think, will one day be far more useful. You can in fact get it in 15 dimensions. Third dimension has some sort of extra information about how this hum comes out. But certainly in some ways, more information is clearly obvious to you. In fact, more information is available because certain aspect of noise is removed when you do this in terms of pictures like this. Next slide, please. And here is a picture that I want to show. And this is a picture based upon what Dr. Sangeeta Menon drew as a picture of lotuses outside of Nias. So this is a simulation of this question about what happens if you take several pictures which are partially overlapping, but they are pixelized. So there are 64 such pictures, all virtually looking the same, all pixelized like this. You know, try to look at this. There is virtually very little structure to be seen here. You don't really know what is happening here or what is happening here. And it is not clearly there in any of this. It is like if you want to know whether Tendulkar had aged the bat or not. You look at the video, you take it one slide at a time, you don't clearly see it. But if you see the whole picture, you suddenly see it. What happens when you put things together? So now you use the idea of embedding that has come out in chaos particular thing. So you say in function space, I'll embed these 64 pictures as one point, and I want to find the path back to the original one. And this is actually a relatively simple case. You say, I'm going to find the path with maximum entropy. I'm going to assume the least in the information theoretic sense. What do you get? Is this picture. And you can see all these things were there. They are all in these 64 images in some sense hidden, but not at all clear. But once you follow these ideas, you get this lovely, beautiful picture out here. You know, I think even at a distance, you probably see the difference between this and this. Okay, next slide, please. So, this play that took place here last Tuesday, called Copenhagen, I'm still enjoying it, and I still think about the story in this particular play. There is this character, Niels Bohr, who they keep calling as the Pope. He is the wise person, his wisdom. And he says, well, I give a few suggestions now and then. He always downplays what he's doing. And then there is Werner Heisenberg. He's the fast skier. He likes to go fast and likes to get answers quickly and rapidly and move. There's this tremendous sheer energy. You know, quoting one of the American generals, damn the torpedoes, full speed ahead. He says, damn the bifurcations, full speed ahead. This wisdom and this energy is an extraordinary combination. Now, what is nice is to be sandwiched between this. Lots of what I am telling you now and what has been going on has been influenced by a very large number of people, Dr. Pradhan and others in this audience for sure. But right now, I'll single out two people. One is, I would call him Pope, that is Professor Narasimha, and the skier is Savita, this high energy particle moving very, very fast. And because of these two people and their interactions, we are doing some rather interesting things related to chaos. Next slide, please. So now we'll go back to the old thing. It's like seeing the cast of characters again. And now you can see some sense of familiarity between all of this. Poincaré, this is the Poincaré section. This is the clockwork, the determinism, the last of the modernism that is now dying. This is the Mandelbrot set, a certain portion of it. This is Sarkowski, the wonderful man who did virtually everything about chaos in some ways. This is the horseshoe that was drawn on this beach. This is the butterfly that comes out of Lorenz's attractor. And this is the thing that made chaos popular, Jurassic Park. And the planets, the wonderful show, because of which we got very much interested for ages to try to understand. Kepler was wonderful, but he was wrong by a factor of a million times in how long the universe has gone on before an observer came out with his theory. I wonder if an author is willing to wait 100 million years for a reader, but 100 years is not a bad time, which is roughly what happened to Poincaré's work, and even Cantor about 50 years at least before his work came to something. So, ask any questions, comments, criticisms. If you feel offended, it was slightly intended. There is not much fun without offending you. So I'll stand in front of you for your comments. Thank you. Yes.